Last video, we talked about the functions of cortisol and aldosterone, as well as how a lack of these corticosteroids cause Addison's disease. What happens, though, when there is instead too much cortisol? Join me in this episode of Medicurio, where we will discuss Cushing syndrome, the counterpart of Addison's disease. There are two types of Cushing syndrome depending on whether the excess cortisol is from inside or outside the body. Unlike Addison's disease, aldosterone is not involved. In endogenous Cushing syndrome, the body itself is producing too much cortisol. Recall from the previous video how the body regulates cortisol production in the adrenal glands. When the hypothalamus releases CRH in times of stress, the anterior pituitary releases ACTH in response, which stimulates the adrenal glands to release cortisol. The released cortisol then stops the anterior pituitary and hypothalamus from releasing their hormones, which then stops cortisol production. Clearly, there is a feedback mechanism to prevent non-stop cortisol release, so why does it occur in Cushing syndrome? Well, if there is a tumor in the anterior pituitary, more cells are producing ACTH, which stimulates more cortisol release. What's more, these anterior pituitary tumors are unresponsive to cortisol and continue to produce ACTH despite cortisol being released, eliminating the feedback mechanism. When endogenous Cushing syndrome is due to an anterior pituitary tumor, it is known as Cushing's disease. Though tumors in the hypothalamus and the adrenal glands can also lead to high cortisol levels, either due to high CRH or high cortisol, Cushing's disease is the most common form of endogenous Cushing syndrome. However, all of these tumors are rare, with around 1 in 1 million people suffering from endogenous Cushing syndrome, with more women than men affected. Let's look at the other type of Cushing syndrome. In exogenous Cushing syndrome, medication is the source of excess cortisol. Corticosteroid medication is not only used to treat Addison's disease, but also immune system diseases such as asthma, arthritis, gout, and other autoimmune diseases. This is because, aside from energy production, cortisol also has the function of suppressing the immune system, which can treat these autoimmune diseases where the immune system is out of control. However, too much corticosteroid medication can over-inhibit the body's natural defenses and result in one of the symptoms of Cushing syndrome, increased risk of infections. The incidence of exogenous Cushing syndrome varies depending on the incidence of the diseases the medication is treating, but it is more commonly seen than endogenous Cushing syndrome. In addition to being more susceptible to infections, Cushing syndrome has many other symptoms: weight gain, bone weakness, and high blood pressure. Recall the other function of cortisol in our body discussed in the previous video. When released in stressful situations, it stimulates energy production so that you have enough energy to fight or run away. What happens, though, after that stress is gone? Cortisol increases appetite so that you eat more food to replenish the energy stores that were used up. Most of us have experienced this increased appetite during or after a stressful situation, colloquially known as stress eating. However, sustained increased levels of cortisol from Cushing syndrome cause stress eating in the absence of a stressful situation. Therefore, since the energy stores were never used up, increased appetite and eating causes rapid weight gain on the face, neck, and stomach. Not only can this rapid weight gain result in stretch marks on the belly, called striae, when the blood vessels near the skin stretch and burst, it can also lead to diabetes, which can eventually cause death. Another function of cortisol is bone breakdown, which is why another symptom of Cushing syndrome is osteoporosis, or weak bones. Bones, aside from providing structural support, also act as storage for calcium. Calcium ions are extremely important because they allow muscles to contract. Therefore, in times of stress, when cortisol is secreted, calcium is released from bone so that the muscles can contract to fight or run. Normally, This calcium is replenished when the stressful situation ends, but if cortisol is continuously released, such as in Cushing syndrome, bones will constantly release their calcium and become weaker and weaker, resulting in osteoporosis. Finally, many with Cushing syndrome suffer from high blood pressure. This is because cortisol and aldosterone are very similar in structure. When cortisol is at extremely high levels, as seen in Cushing syndrome, it can also stimulate aldosterone receptors in the cell to cause effects similar to those of aldosterone. Since aldosterone increases blood pressure, high blood pressure is a common symptom of Cushing syndrome. In addition, cortisol itself has a property of causing blood vessels to squeeze and get narrower, which further increases blood pressure. High blood pressure will damage the heart, blood vessels, brain, and kidneys, all of which can lead to premature death. The main method of treating both exogenous and endogenous Cushing syndrome is to decrease cortisol levels. Treating exogenous Cushing syndrome is quite simple. Decrease the dose of the corticosteroid medications, or perhaps discontinue it altogether and look for an alternative treatment for whatever disease the medication was treating. One thing to watch out for when discontinuing corticosteroid treatment is to avoid suddenly stopping the medication. Recall that cortisol, either produced by the body or from medication, inhibits ACTH release. This is a natural response to prevent too much cortisol production. However, because there is very little ACTH released, the adrenal glands are rarely stimulated and waste away from disuse. If medication is suddenly stopped and ACTH begins to be released again, the adrenal glands are often so wasted away that they cannot produce cortisol, leading to an Addisonian crisis. Therefore, it is important to slowly decrease cortisol medication and allow time for the adrenal glands to recover. On the other hand, treating endogenous Cushing syndrome, such as Cushing's disease, is more difficult. By surgically removing the tumors, for example, on the anterior pituitary, excessive ACTH is no longer produced, resulting in normal cortisol levels. If the tumor is too large, the entire anterior pituitary may have to be removed, resulting in the body now no longer producing any ACTH, and as a consequence, no cortisol. Therefore, the patient must be supplemented with cortisol to prevent Addison's disease. Cushing syndrome and Addison's disease are both opposite and intertwined with each other. Treating one of them may lead to the other if not done correctly. Since in most of the cases, Cushing syndrome is due to excess steroid medications, this disease also teaches us a valuable lesson. Follow instructions carefully when taking medication, and contact your doctor immediately if you are experiencing side effects. Thanks for watching, and see you next time for another explanation of a disease on Medicurio.